Well, thank you, Helen. I have to say, this is already such a fantastic ambiance for this conference. Just so looking forward to it. As Helen said, I'm Amanda Haste. I'm here on behalf of the National Coalition of Independent Scholars, actually an international organization. And I'm just so pleased that whether people have chosen to give an affiliation or not, that we're all here on our own merits as researchers. So, yay. I think what's really interested me, and I'm not going to go on and on, is that what we're doing in this 2 days is we're embracing and exploring and celebrating all the different ways in which we conduct our research, and they are many. I'm pretty sure that we're not going to have anybody reading off PowerPoint slides in the next 2 days, thank God. I'd like to introduce our first keynote speaker, whom I had the pleasure of meeting yesterday, amazing woman. And she's had a sort of a threefold career. She's been active in the creative arts as an artist. She's been involved in teaching at primary and secondary levels and in higher education. Her PhD is seen basically in creativity and Pam, tell me if I'm wrong, it's on temporality in improvisation and composition, which as a musicologist myself is of huge interest. And she has, I'm not in the spirit of not reading off PowerPoint slides, I am not going to read you her entire biography because you can read it yourselves. So I would just say she's written loads of books which are amazing, including the one that you can see there, which is called Doing Rebellious Research in and Beyond the Academy. Need I say more? I present Pam Burnard.
It is such a pleasure to be in a room with passionate people and to be in a room where we've got people in the academy and mostly beyond the academy, which is so fresh, and the vitality of what that brings, I think, is immeasurable. I have had three careers. I am a disruptor. I had someone over the summer program, I was teaching 66 Chinese second year economic students, creativities and AI. And one of them said,
You don't look. like a Cambridge professor. And I said, that is the nicest thing anyone has said to me. I don't want to look like a Cambridge professor. I don't know what an academic is. I know what an artist is. I know what an educator is. And I'm not that keen about this academia where we seem to see ourselves in a silo and often as a dinosaur, being seen as dinosaurs. So I'm here to disrupt. And it will be interactive. It's a challenge, really, in the way you're all sitting and so forth. But I hope to involve you, each and every one of you, in the next hour in ways that get you thinking about yourself and about research and this word creative research and my most famous word of all, rebellion. This book was developed over COVID. I got so tired of going on Zoom, going into Zoomiverse, and just seeing people sort of sit there just from the bottom up, no legs, and basically talk for 45 minutes, and then we'd all have a Q&A. So I developed a one-hour session once a month where we had one question or one topic, and I'd invite four people to perform their research. Not to talk about their research, but to perform it. So you had this sort of view of the same question from a performative space. People were writing in chat, and then we'd have a discussion at the end, or it wouldn't be. It'd be another performance by the audience. And then we decided to put all of that into a book. So whilst I'm not trying to sell this book, because I don't, we're not making any money out of it at all, it is an exemplification of how publishers can think differently. It was a battle. And if you do nothing else, you know, after the few minutes after or later, I'll leave this book here for you to have a look. It's just a look inside it to see the rebellion in terms of practice, I think is something worthwhile. So let's begin with what I hope will be very much, and I can just put this down and there won't be any sounding vibrations and resonations and resonances. This word rebel, I wanted to play Gary Glitter's, you know, rebel, yell, but I thought, no, that's a bit obvious. I like the word rebel and I use it deliberately. And we spent 10 pages in this book defining from a whole range what is a rebel. And basically all artists are rebels. I think all educators are rebels. And I think all researchers who are pushing boundaries are rebels. So to against, in opposition to, or to just do it again, but to do it differently. Bell, meaning obstinate, stubborn, revolt and rebel. So many of us have been told, you can't do that. As soon as somebody says that to me, I'm one of five. I'm the baby of five children from a little country town you wouldn't have heard of in Australia. I'm the only one that went to university. I knew there was something else. So to push against what you're told you can't do is important. And to be rebellious researchers, to write rebelliously, is to push against the conventions that are out there. Some publishers don't like it. Many don't like it. Many academics think, oh, the arty one. Fine. Okay, no problem. That's the way you want to see me. That's fine. But at this point, the innovation that comes from the line of flight of rebellion, and I'll come back to that line of flight, we're going to perform the line of flight, is not something that's violent. It's not something that's a battle, but rather it is wise, it's loving, it's about relationality, and it's about an orientation to the world that I think we live by, like metaphors. So with that in mind, I have written a poem. Oh, get the microphone. Yes, I heard you. I heard you say it. Hello. I got the microphone. I'm just going to perform this. This is Brian Eno's app, which is called Bloom. Beautiful, beautiful app. And I'm just going to show you while I put this down for a second.
I want to invite you to think of the impossible, to think of the possible, to think of I'm possible. About rebellion in research through collaborative exchange, about researching with, about writing with, about rupturous inquiry reimagined in resistance. And I invite you to wonder with Karen Barad, Bell Hooks, Rosie Brodotti, Elizabeth McKinley, Guattari and Deleuze, Elizabeth St. Pierre, Maxine Green, who said, I am, ... not yet. And others. I invite you to join the group that Elizabeth McKinley started called Departing Radically in Academic Writing, acronym DRAW. To simultaneously perform while materializing weeness, highness, me search,
Research. Research. And I come to you risk-taking. It's much easier for me to play a Beethoven sonata, honestly, in public than it is to do this. And vulnerably performing research. Research. And daring a new transaction with you, a new transaction to arrive at a new research endeavor. I hope this happens this time during these 2 days. You're welcome to come and play it later. Of course, there's going to be, if I'm going to be rebellious, I'm going to mess with the sound, and I apologize to all those at home. I move around a bit, so I'll try and catch up. I just played a beautiful app by Brian Eno called Bloom. Download it now while we're talking. It does beautiful things when you're in trains and you're playing with your head and all these gorgeous patterns come up. Also look at his 10 worlds. There's 10 sound worlds and people are thinking, what is she doing? And the sound is just gorgeous. It's really quite meditative. So think about that. We claim we need radical departures, and yes, we do. We need new agendas, and we need to restructure. We need to do many things. Some of the things we need to do, we can do in the next 2 days to set up the next year and come back next year and report. So asking the question, what if? I love that. What if we were to? And what else should we do? Well, I'm hoping to unsettle and really you, yep, seatbelts on, floaters, and think, how can I push against these outmoded assumptions about research that I find stale and such as constraining? How do we learn? What do we learn from rebellious research? What do we learn about being a researcher when doing rebellious research? If you don't like that word, call it rupturing research. Call it, what was the word we were speaking about, Amanda? Disruptive research. Love it. Disruptive. And how can we co-create? Doing it together to support each other, which is what this community is going to be and do beyond these 2 days for catalyzing change. Look at this line of flight. Look at this beautiful way of thinking of a line of flight, which we're going to just experiment with shortly. It's actually a term by Deleuze and Guattari. Many of you will know this term. And it offers the possibility of escape. It offers this sort of elusive moment when change happens, to actually document it, to be aware of it, to actually visibly live it. And it shows this threshold between two or three lines. When they're crossed, when lines are crossed, what happens? So now I'm going to, if it moves, just seems to be a little, I invite you, here it is, to remember the moment, each and one of you, to remember the moment when you did something truly and utterly rebellious. I asked my husband this, I was shocked. I thought I knew him. Something so unruly, disruptive, and ungovernable that once you'd begun, there was no turning back. Think of it. Think of an example, because you don't know which quarter of this room I'm coming to do some line of flight wool throwing. Do you remember what it felt like? Quote Kathleen Stewart, amazing author and inspirer, in her book Writing Life. She says, to dash through and fly because your writing life depended on it. This feeling of doing something and not being able to stop. To dash through and fly because your writing life depends on it. So think now. Think about, what do you remember? Up moment. Some of you may have many moments. Wow. But think of one at the moment when you did something truly and utterly rebellious. What did it feel like? Just write down or think and keep that word in your head, please. One word. What did it feel like?
And as a juggler, I'm going to do two things at once, which we always do, don't we, as researchers? This is wall throwing. We're going to create a line of flight and some interconnections and some cross connections. With each ball of beautiful wool from New Zealand, the best wool, I'm going to just let enough out, leaving it on the floor so that stays with me. This is the technique, and I'll show you where to find these techniques. Then I'm going to get enough so that I can throw it to someone. And I was a basketballer. The back row, I'm ambitious, but not that ambitious. And this wool, I don't think will make it. And I haven't got enough to keep going, but I've got something else for you to do. But for now, I'm focusing, as you can tell, on this lovely group here, because we're going to make the beginnings of an installation that all of you are contributing to, and it will hang somewhere, probably out there or here in here for the rest of this conference. Maybe it'll even be kept for the next conference, and we'll just continue to have an installation that grows as an ecology of this community. So when I throw this to you, can you just give us one word that you've already thought of? One word, that's all. Catch the ball. While you're actually saying that one word loudly, and I'll repeat it, can you unravel enough that you've got some left at the floor, or that you just hold it, but enough to throw it to someone else? And in the interest of safety and fire hazards, we're going to stick this stay with this activity here for about 5 minutes, throwing wool. When I bought this from John Lewis yesterday, the lady said, "What are you going to do with this wool? I've not seen people buy this sort of wool, these three colours and this. What are you going to do?" I said, "You'd be surprised." I did tell her. Are you ready over here? So, you know, all you're going to do is put your hand up and catch it and then say the word. Excited. Do you want to unravel? Beautiful word. Excited. It's something excited. It's something that we all feel when we're doing research. So would you like to stand up? Thank you so much. And throw on. Beautiful. And keep holding your bit and sit down. Thank you. What's your word? Sorry? Naughty. Talk my language. Can you unravel this? Naughty. Is that a beautiful word? Naughty. There's a book called The Naughty Girls, and it's a book about secondary school students who were always branded the naughty girls. One of the authors is Morag Morrison. I think people will know her from Australia. Are you ready to throw? Watch at the front row, because you just know what's going to happen. You don't want to have a wool ball hitting your back of your head. Turn around. Let's see what happens. Thrilling. It is exciting. It is thrilling. And it is naughty. Whoa, beautiful. Back row. Oh, alienated. One feels alienated. I often feel alienated. I often feel like I don't fit. Do you? And it's one of the reasons why I go to so many conferences, because I always feel as if I do fit. You know, you find your tribe, don't you? And it sticks with you and stays with you. Have you got someone to throw? Look, watch everybody. You just never know. It's coming.
Full of mischievous,
which is a beautiful word that one tends to feel when you've got a mask on in those business meetings, in those, you know, where you are chairing the academic board and you're feeling all these things, but you're looking another way. I always wear my best underwear when I'm chairing the faculty board. I don't know why I have to do that. I know that might be too much information to too many people, but there are ways that we perform all our multiple selves, right? Multiple selves. So we'll just stop, stay there with that color, because we're going to look at another color shortly, which is, what is the page of a book? Look at the lines. Just hold the wool up if you don't mind, those people that have wool. Hold them right. Actually, stand up if you don't mind. Fantastic. We started a web. We've started lines of flight that are already crossing around how we feel when we're being rebellious, we're mischievous, we feel naughty. We should we feel naughty? Or should we feel entrepreneurial? Should we feel innovative? Should we feel like Elon Musk? My mind has gone blank. I'm trying to. Should we feel like when we're writing that, you know, we're actually engaging in connecting these lines of flight with other people, with other communities, with other tribes? So thank you. Take a seat, please. Now I'm going to add a different question. So it's a different color. So, you know, with a different color comes a different question. And this time, I'm still staying with you. I'm sorry, I know you think I'm picking on you. You thought you've got the best seat in the house, didn't you? Well, it's all about creative research methods. What's creative research? When is research not creative? When does creative research actually engage in new knowledge? My question to this group now, with this color, this green for go, give me another word for creative research. One word that actually explodes in your mind when you think creative research. Not creative cooking, not creative economy, not creative bioeconomics, not creative music playing, creative research. What's another, an alternative word? Is there a better one? Coming. Well caught. What's your word? Flow. Flow. Like Csikszentmihalyi's flow. You feel an immersion. Time stops and you just are in, not out. You're in flow. Connected. So creative research, connected research. Connected research, absolutely. Connecting to theory, connecting to voices that are taking us further beyond where we've been. Beautiful word, connection, connectivity, very much part of the deal. Here we go. Watch out, everybody. Alert, alert, wool thrown. Different, different. Okay, so it's different. What's different about it? So it's not just doing the same old, it's thinking differently. It's doing differently, knowing differently, being different. Different, it's a beautiful word. Last throw. Way, well done. Playful, creative research is playful. I must say, when you're working in research groups and you're doing creative research in groups, it is very playful. There is something essential about the role of play and playing with and making with in creative research. Just stand, everybody who's got the wool. And here we have this network forming. Whoa, look at that. Now look where the colors intersect. Look where the color, two colors meet, or one color meets and overlaps. And just see how people are holding them up. They're all at different levels. It's absolutely no problem at all. There's nothing you can do that can upset anything here. Fantastic. We begin. Please take a seat, but don't let go of your wall. Thank you so much. Now, time always moves so quickly, and we must move on because there's other things. I now invite you to reflect on Bell Hooks' work on thinking in action. That's what we were doing, thinking in action. We're still doing it. And she writes about words, love, hope, real-world solution actioning, which inspires us to develop me-search. Research is not disconnected. You cannot bracket yourself. You can't leave your clothes at the door and come in with all the values gone. It's impossible. You're at the center of the search. And we search because we are working as researchers and representing communities and people. It's a we-ness, the we-ness, not I-ness. It's together and research as a practice of freedom. A practice of freedom. This really blew my mind, like that quote by Maxine Grin, I am ... not yet. She writes, the moment we choose to love, we begin to move towards freedom, to act in ways that liberate ourselves and others. The action is the testimony of love as the practice of freedom. And when we choose to move against fear, and we do have to choose to move against fear because people will try and stop you. Publishers will try and stop you. Authors will try and stop you. Don't be stopped. So here is another job I'm going to give. Of course, you cannot have research methods, creative research methods conference run by Helen Carroll without bringing these. These are very essential parts of the tools for creative research making. They do amazing things. You open my eyes to the possibility. And, you know, I've been building shapes ever since we met at your first conference. This was the one I made today in recognition of Helen's inspiration. I'm just going to give this to you. And it says there's a whole meaning which I need to sit and talk to you about, which is embodied in there. But I'm going to just pass these along. Your job in this side of the room is really important because you're going to look at that word freedom and take one or maybe two of these. I don't know. Some people need two. Some need three. Share it across the row. Of what does freedom look like? What does it look like? If that's too hard or it's too simple, what does it feel like? And allow these things to work on you because they will. These will work on you. It is a collaborative task between you and these incredible things called pipe cleaners. It's a terrible name, isn't it? And what will then happen is that your creations will articulate, just hold up your wool again, will articulate every connecting part. Every time the wool connects, we will attach your symbolism for freedom. Look, they're right into it. They just, your hands move, the materiality of movement, of doing, of being, and making with. So that's part two. There is a part three if you feel left out at the back. I'm coming. Don't worry. Okay. Now, Jennifer Walsh. This is an amazing piece of music. They're performing her composition. She's on the left. No, the sound is on. Disruption. The sound is on. They're performing. There's no technical hitch here. And just to prove it to you, here's the score. What does this feel like? What does it feel like? Is that music? Is that sound? Is that a performance? I can do that. Those questions are disrupting. They're rupturing your view of what music and a composer is. Here's another example. Can't hear it. Can you make it louder? Please. Rowan.
I can hear it in Zoom.
You can. What's that? That's what she's doing underneath that paper bag. And that's the performance. She's also gesturing. There's gestures that go on. So the gesture of the body is central, as it was to the first performance. The body is central, no problem at all. Improvisation. Let's look at my absolute shero, Bjork, for just a few minutes. And she disrupts everything about the creative industry because she brings children on tour with her. She brings her music choir. She collaborates with everybody, there's particularly technology people, and she collaborates with more than humans. In other words, nature. So now we have this introduction of more than humans, humans and non-humans in technology. It is a collaboration. And what she's doing here is really getting this possibility of a rebellious practice using CGI and the agency of possibility. I'm going to just give you a snapshot of this.
There's no,
you've got it there? Okay. It almost doesn't matter, really. Just look at the CGI. When is it CGI? When is it a human? And let me. And look at the nature culture. Karen Burrard and Manning, Masumi, and others are bringing this word nature culture as if it's one word, no hyphen, no space. Actually, the relationship of nature to culture is that they are inextricably linked. Let's move it a little bit along. Do me, promise me that you will, it's okay. Yep, I'm all right. There we go. Promise me you'll look at this when you go home. It's called body memory. And there's something very powerful about the body. Look at those school children. When is it a human? When is it a non-human? When is it more than human? What is our relationship to nature? I can't call this music. This is more than just music. This is involving transdisciplinary skills, creativities, with the lines of flight connected and the exquisiteness of bodies. And the metamorphosis occurring between humans and more than humans. How do we represent that in our research? How are we moving to represent new thinking about, with, through technology? Ancestor use of technology and the materiality of more than human. It's a beautiful thing to listen to, and I invite you to do that when you go home. The key assertions I'm making is that the possible, what she made possible there, and she has a belt that is a harp that's designed accordingly to be able to play, I want it. She wears a beautiful costume that's molecules. So she shows the relationship of arts to science, inextricably linked again. She performs her ideas. She performs her belief, her practice as an artist and as a disruptor. The possible is distributed though. She doesn't do it alone. The possible, what could be, is entwined with the actual, what is. They're not separate. What is showing you, inviting you into what if we could.
go further. And that experience of the possible transforms. So at this moment, maybe you'll feel re-motivated to ask new questions, maybe not. Maybe you just think, okay, I know all this, I've done this before, this is not new. Or maybe it's time to return to things that we know that we're familiar with, to go beyond and work with the unfamiliar and ask, what if, what else? So possibility thinking, possibility, what if, is about revisioning things. The me search, the we search, research, researching with new ideas, with new framing. Maybe you might use onto ethico epistemological voicings, new ways. That's a beautiful Haraway word that, you know, I remember when I started to do a PhD, we did had a lecture on ontology, the next week on epistemology, and about 10 weeks later at the end of the course on ethics. Yes. I mean, how wrong was that? And I remember saying to the lecturer, I really don't get this paradigm thing, you know. I mean, can you tell us a bit more? And he'd already given us a lecture for 2 hours. And he said, just go to the library and read for 6 months. Yeah, good. What an answer. So possibility thinking. What are we doing in our own research? Think of something you're researching at this moment, and how could you re-envision the next stage? Add a new phase. What if we were to reconsider what a new special issue in a new journal might look like with a new network? I don't want to say a new publisher because I don't want to offend the one that's here. So with this publisher who's going to be thinking newly, what might it look like? So in the back rows, I'm going to invite them to select one Dixit card. I'm going to go up with several packs, and I want you to choose one. Just pass them along the row and ask us, pick one only, that you see something in this Dixit card, their storytelling cards, that liberates you and liberates new possibilities not yet realized. Now, these Dixit cards I use all the time. You know, it may well be we need to also add them to the installation, but take one. Yes, can we go? The other side, the other, turn it around. That's it. Now, what you see in these Dixit cards are really complex textured images, metaphors. And they're not just one thing. You keep looking in them and you see more. I'm inviting people at the back to do this job quickly, you know, to sort of take one that sort of resonates and pass it along and just look at this card. What do you see in this card? And let it act on you. Look and see, what do you identify with? What is in there that helps you to think differently, to liberate new possibilities? If it was to become the iconic symbol for your research project that you're doing, what is in this card that links to your research or your practice as research? And pull out three words. And in a few minutes, I'll come up the back with the microphone and I'll ask three people to volunteer their three words. Now, those Dixit cards, they're storytelling cards. I use them all the time with children, with teacher education, research teaching, research methods, because you can ask any question of these cards and they'll speak back to you. And of course, if you put them together in a group, then the group can come up with a storyline that connects the cards. The opportunities are endless. But I'm looking at research and creative research and rebellious research. What is in this card that sort of ignites something that liberates your thinking? What if I was to, we were to? What comes to your mind? several EdD students and PhD students have done these very things. This chap, Dr. Barry Rogers, who is at the London School of Economics, he drew storyboards as sense-giving tools for his EdD. He was sponsored by Shell to keep the creative lines of that organization open. 5-year part-time whilst he worked at the LSE. And he used storyboards and he used metaphors. He used the Dixit cards. He developed an app to kind of open up people to think differently about how they work together. And in his dissertation, he wrote to sort of two audiences simultaneously, to the very conventional thesis reading dissertation and to those that are into EdDs. You'll know that they're portfolio dissertations and they can look very different to a traditional PhD structure, not so linear. So he came up with storyboards. Rebecca Heaton, on the other hand, put her contents into two, presented it in two ways. The contents on the left, space one, space two, space three. She called those chapters spaces. Nice word. And then she also created an exhibition, a painting for each of the chapters. And she called each chapter exhibition one, exhibition two, exhibition three. So at her registration viva, these paintings were present, and she'd already actually had an exhibition of her dissertation drawn. Very nice work. She drew a lot. Here's another of the shared analysis she used to draw and write, and her data kind of looked like art as well. So how does data look? How does analysis look? How should it look? Oh, well, I'd rather ask, how can it look? How might it look? Look differently. This girl, Katie Nash, is doing her EdD, and she basically draws a storyboard. She's looking at empathy, and this is a table of contents. See the methodology left side, timeline, methods of data collection, and she's actually going to animate this. So it becomes an animation. And it lives. It's a living inquiry, which is visual, but more graphic, but more very empowering and impactful. Because if your research is not going to be read and understood by the public, why are we bothering if it's not going to make a change? So I'm not talking about, you know, arty stuff, you know, that's they're just art. Yeah, I'm talking about. Don't wander, come back. I'm talking about impact, communicating with people. And interestingly enough, with that book, it got into The Guardian. People got interested in this because we were saying that research is not impactful and it needs to be much more accessible. And we got some traction. I was interviewed for an hour and a half because there's a circus artists in there. There's a rapper from London who also works in community arts, writing about rebellious research, about rebellious practice, about practices that disrupt. It's on page 13 of the Saturday that there was the Jubilee celebration for the Queen. And the Queen took up 12 pages, and on page 13, Cambridge Researchers Rebellion. And it was, whoa, I mean, I honestly, it was, you know, better than turning 21 and getting promoted, and not as good as my wedding day, but, you know, it was up there, you know? I mean, that you can get yourself in the paper because you're pushing the boundary. I can send you that, or just Google Cambridge Rebellion, you know, whatever the month of the Queen's Jubilee was on a Saturday. So how to do differently? Kieran Sheena, also another EdD, finished recently. His research was done with, in partnership, in collaboration, co-authoring with politicians, policemen, psychologists, social workers, and research, artist researchers. And he was looking at professions, how professions are constructed. And he would dance. He's not a dancer. He just moves. He would move in the interview and record it and then play it back, inviting response, inviting a reply, inviting engagement, intra-action. Sometimes people got up and moved with him. Movement is, the body is so important in those workshops. And he called it video wandering. And he drew from Hickey Moody, you'll know her, and the readings of Deleuze and Guattari, post-humanism. Embodiment, diffraction, and transdisciplinary knowledge generation is in this piece. But movement was central.
I think...
And here is his understanding of the concepts and the overlapping, like our lines of flight overlapped over here. These are each lines of wool, the dancing body, poetic considerations, fiction as a diffractive practice. Notice they're all with a theorist after it. Performance as a relational shape. Here's another shape. And this is in the book written by this chapter by David Russell at RMIT in Melbourne. And he worked with children, 3 or 4 years old. And they were exploring the incredible wood wide web. It's tricky to say. And it involved a collaboration with an artistic group called Barking Spider Visual Theatre in Melbourne. And they were exploring how trees communicate under the ground through mycelium networks. It's an amazing thing how trees communicate. Again, this is what I was seeing in Bjork, this communication of nature and more than nature, of humans and more than humans. And here he's working with 3 or 4 year olds. What did he do? Did they do? Well, they went outside and basically after a series of outdoor encounters, and I'm reading from this, what a way to write up, Okay, stop, or I've got 5 minutes. Okay, without questions.
You've got
5 and stop. And in another chapter, this is about sensations, exchanging sensations of time through art, media, and pedagogy. This is written by Tricia McRae, who's the artist, the media artist, David again, and Portia Angley, who's an EdD student of ours. And they write to each other, and those emails become the data. They start, I could not shake through the skin up the staircase of sensation, pattern shapes emerging, myself mingling. It's like a poem, but it's actually speaking to the progression, the process of writing this chapter, which is filled with imaginary images and the sensation of time. So it's a performance embodied in the chapter. I can't tell you how hard it was to get the publisher to go with us with this. And I had to work with every Australian-ness of myself to kind of keep her open to thinking this is going to be good for your company. This is going to be good for you. People are going to really think, wow, real eye sense. That's who I'll go to after I've worked with the publisher who's present here. I mean, you go to Routledge and they will only do black and white. Doesn't matter how beautiful. Or if you do, you pay a lot of money for 1 or 2 color plates. This There was no charge. And look at the text. And the text is telling us, it is data and it's analysis. You'll need to read the chapter to do it, but I'm just giving you this look of the design, the form. It's a performance of imaginaries in space and time with an artist working in collaboration. And Tricia had never worked with academics before. She thinks we're a pretty weird bunch, I must say. But, you know, look at the references. This is a scholarly, academic piece of work. We talk about Elizabeth McKinley, who is the founder of DRAW, departing radically in academic writing. And part two is full of PhD students working with her collective, of people wanting to write differently. And they meet every month. Online, and you too can become a member. They're on Facebook as well. Incredible work, drabbling, write 100 words. Do it every morning before breakfast. It's a bit like kind of doing your Tai Chi or doing your exercises. 100 words, you get to know how long 100 words is, just free. It's like playing a Bach prelude and fugue as you sort of exercise for the morning. Very, very nutritious way to incorporate writing, not as a chore, but as a living inquiry, as a living thing that's part of your life. That has a chapter all about that. Writing a poem to introduce yourself, like Eloise does again in part two, and others do as well. An introduction, you get it very quickly, what she does and what her PhD is about. And this is 100 words, how to do it differently. And Emma Cook, just put your hands up, Emma. Thank you. I don't have to say anything. It's okay. Emma has a chapter, a brilliant chapter in this book, and she's here. Just put your hand up again so they can see you. Talk to her about her chapter and about her experience of being in that DRAW collective. So what just happened? What matters? It matters what matters. We use to think other matters with. I love that, you know, using that word matters. It matters what matters. We use to think other matters with. It matters what stories we tell. It matters what stories make worlds. And it matters what trouble we stir up, staying with the trouble, as Haraway says. So thinking again of these lines of flight, thinking of the overlapping, the connecting of ideas, thinking of, and we will take your beautiful idea. Could you just hold your that's it.
So here we have these amazing metaphors for freedom. It's therapy just looking at it, honestly. And what we'll do with these metaphors for freedom is use them to connect with. So if you don't mind staying there just for 3 minutes while we do that. And then I'll go up here and just simply ask two people rather than three, put your hand up if you'd like to share, rather than me, who'd like to just share their card, hold it up. I'll walk up with it. And you just have to say three words. I love you. That's nice. Oh, great. What's your three words, David?
Playing despite adversity. Despite adversity.
Playing despite adversity. Clever. Three words in a phrase. Playing despite adversity. Did you take a photo of this? Good, because you should keep this. Playing despite adversity. We will hang this from our assemblage. Playing. Despite adversity, despite, not instead of, despite, in reaction to, in reply to. I love that. Thank you. I'll never look at that card the same again. One more, please. Who else? Huh? Yes, on the right-hand side. How are we here? Everybody good? What's this?
Between different dimensions.
Between different dimensions. Did you take a photo? Great. Isn't that interesting? You want to keep it. You want to acknowledge that this is something that will inspire you tomorrow and the day after, between different dimensions. Between. I think that word, between. Yes, yes, please. Between, okay. And almost, I'll bring that back to you, is to say, so what? One must learn how to think and write the new and not yet. The new, and quote Maxine Green, not yet, I am, dot, 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 not yet. Which is not so much a question of personal choice, it's a bid for survival, literally. We must think the new, right across the globe, as well as in this room, in order to survive. And if you have a look and take a picture of that QR code with your phone, you'll see all of these activities that I implemented in Portugal, Aveiro University, two days ago with 20-year-old university students in economics, working with bioeconomics and wanting to apply creative thinking, creative learning, creativities. Thank you for being an amazing interactive audience.
Thank you so much, Pam. It kind of feels like an imposition to put an end to this, to say, oh, we're running out of time. Feels like we shouldn't be putting these sort of boundaries on what you have to say. Because we don't have much time for questions, I'm going to prioritize the questions from the online attendees, because you are here and you can ask questions in person. So, first question from online, from Daniela Fernandez. She says, Pam, is the evidence generated seen as robust enough by mainstream academia and beyond, for example, for policy, or is it its own niche?
Oh, great question. It's been asked many, many times. Yes, it can be. If you set it up so that it's framed, it's embodied and embedded in theoretical work, and you're building on other research, it doesn't have to be either or. It can be embodied in the most traditional looking mixed methodology, but the practices that you use in one or two of the phases, or where you, when you're working with them, respondent verification. Oh yeah, nice word, isn't it? Respondent verification, very scientific, very objective, then you can engage people and go deep. Do a deep hangout with your participants, with your policy makers. Remember Sheehan, Kieran Sheehan, who interviewed politicians, policemen, not politicians. Well, yes, I think it was politicians, policemen, priests. Why not get your politicians in there as participants? We used to call it elite. Hello, I've just seen someone I know. Elite interviews, very posh. And your elite interviews can be disruptive. But remember, these are sharp scalpels, and you need to set up the situation, set up the context, and also when you're, you know, completing it, to make sure there's ways, strategies for ensuring you don't leave open wounds. They are sharp scalpels, and they can, it's about rigor, it's about significance, and it's about originality. They're the three things that get you into the ref, that get you into journals. And this, it's how you set it up, it's how you frame it, and how you write it up. Remember, Barry Rogers, he wrote in two voices, two registers, one for the very traditional theory, you know, dissertation reader, and one for the portfolio. Yes, it's a harder gig. Well, that's life.
Thank you so much. Okay, we've got time for one last question. Oh, it's taken me on to emojis. So obviously looked at the program. another question from Rachel Burnett this time. I went to a fantastic conference about playful learning, and almost every session mentioned how difficult it is to quantify the value of play and creativity. And there were many stories about the academy not taking the resulting research seriously. Is this something that you've come up against, and are things improving?
Yes and yes. But I mean, quantify means you're measuring, I assume. And I've always said, when you're talking about creativity, which creativity are you measuring? And then we can go deep on the dimensions of that. You can measure creative thinking, you measure creative critical thinking. But when you say I'm measuring creativity, it's probably going to be a Torrance test. And we need to move beyond that into the 21st century and into 2023. It looks different in different cultures and in different spaces in same countries. So it's a complex answer, maybe situated. You've got to situate your measurement. Everybody's into the performative agenda. So to play that game, but to do more is my first answer. And yes, there is always opposition. And so you've got to get your arguments, your ducks in a row, get your community together behind you, get the theory and the framing all set up, and do it.
Thank you. Okay, I think we've got time for one last online question. This is a really short one from Lucy. What would you say you or we are rebelling against?
It's a beautiful question. So many things. I mean, I think we have our own, inside demons, if you like, things that we're rebelling against, that we have just assumptions we were sold. I'm a country girl. I come from a family of five. No one else went to university. So when I read Bourdieu, cultural sociology, it made so much sense. But I'd been done over. You know, I'd been sold ideas and things and structures and ways of working. So I'm rebelling again. I've got a fire in the belly bigger than a fire should be, because I've been, sold ideas that are just not true. So that fuels me, that fires me up. So that's one thing, that's a personal thing. From a collective perspective with your research team, then you've got to meet the rules of the game and get the funders to pay up and to get them to shut up, then you've got to do what you said you were going to do, but you need to do much more. And it's what I see in schools in the UK, in England at least, for Ofsted inspections, when they get outstanding, they're ticking the boxes, but man, they're doing so much more. And the same thing happens in university Ofsted inspections. So, you've got to be true to yourself, but play the game. And that's a balance. It's hard to do, but it's possible.
Thank you so much. Well, that's all we have time for. So a big thank you to Pam.